Welcome back to Podsauce. I am so excited, mostly because Alesha is so freaked out by our next guest. We got Trevor Shand here from the Boo Crew podcast, which is all about creepy movies.
I'm not here for it.
Come on, get with it.
No, Trevor, mind you, like, I'm from the South. Like, I hug, I dab. I haven't given Trevor any energy.
It's true.
I'm looking at this earring.
When he walked up here, I gave him a handshake, and she was like, hi.
I didn't even know she said hi, actually, really.
I feel like there's an apparition going to jump from you to him. Like, hi, Trevor.
Hey. Nice to meet you.
Odyssey family. Thank you for taking some time
out. No problem. Thanks for having me.
Man, listen. So, first things first.
First things first, Alesha wore a cross today.
Yeah, I noticed that. I did notice that.
Just in case it starts getting real weird, I'm warding it off. Why? Why, Trevor? In your spare time? Is this what we're doing?
I mean, it's horror and everything associated with it is not only a spare time thing. It's really...
It's a lifestyle.
Yeah, it really is a lifestyle.
It's a movement.
Yeah, it pretty well is. From wall to wall in the house when you walk in, I have four kids. Everyone's immersed in the art and lifestyle of horror and haunted things and things like that. I've just been fascinated with it. I think because it was a forbidden fruit when I was growing up. I wasn't really allowed to watch horror films. It was something my dad would go downstairs where they'd have his own little TV room and he'd be watching horror movies. And it was kind of like, you leave the basement door closed, don't come down, I'm watching a scary movie. Mm-hmm. And then when I got old enough to experience it myself, I dived in. Yeah. I was got obsessed. Like, what is he doing behind that
door? So what does your house look like then? You say wall-to-wall horror, like, what does that mean?
Yeah, well, as soon as you walk in the house, we wrapped it all in old wood paneling and wallpaper, like Victorian printed wallpaper.
Spectacular.
And then started collecting props, screen-used props from horror films that we love. Also fantasy films. There's a lot of life-size statues when you walk in the house. There's a life-size Voldemort and Harry Potter having a wand battle as soon as you walk in. And then you look up, and we have all the costumes from the movie Shaun of the Dead, a zombie comedy that came out.
That sounds awesome.
All kind of set up.
Yeah.
There's the dining room table. There's no room for anyone to eat because there's a prosthetic leg from a horror movie that was amputated in an old sandbox. And the dollhouse from Ari Aster's 2018 film Hereditary sitting in the middle of the dining room table. Rick Baker zombies everywhere that
we were able to accumulate. Your house is the spot.
It's always Halloween.
You know what's funny? I wasn't always this way. Okay? So don't bring your judgment over here. I saw it in your eye. I'm curious to know if you really know this. Rawhead Rex. Do you remember that movie?
I do remember it, yes.
Mad, dusty, old.
Yeah.
But that was one of my first, like, experiences.
That's quite the first experience, too.
For sure. Bram Stoker's Dracula was the one that kept me up at night, though.
Wow.
What was the first horror film that kept you up at night? Because for me, it was Bram Stoker's Dracula. I wasn't even bothered by Rawhead Rex.
Sure.
We watched it so much, my mother and my dad burned the VHS. A VHS, kids, is the format that we used to watch movies on before. What was it for you?
Nightmare on Elm Street Part 3.
Really?
Yeah. Okay. Very first exposure to Freddy Krueger and that whole world. Because he is really the perfect villain. You cannot escape Freddy Krueger. Everybody's got to sleep, right?
As
a kid, you know, anything's possible in your dreams. So that freaked me out. And that was really the first one I saw.
But that third one right there, though, wasn't that the one where they all had, like, special
superpowers and they fight against him? I think that was the only reason that I could actually deal with it, right?
Right?
Yeah.
But here's the thing. That particular one is the one that actually made it possible for me to get through some horror films, because that one was hilarious.
Sure, yeah.
Which I'm going to bring it back to the recent episode that you guys talked to the creator of Saw.
Yes.
Because, about bringing the elements of comedy in, because I know it's Samuel L. Jackson.
Yeah, and Chris Rock.
Yeah. Because when Freddie said, Lego this, Lego my ego, or karate chop this, I hollered. Is Freddy getting with the 1-2 snap?
Yeah, he's funny.
So I do think that there is something to say about bringing the element of comedy into horror so that you can make it more palatable.
Well, your adrenaline's already going up, and you add that element of funny, it's just complimentary.
It also just makes it more palatable for the scaredy cats
like me.
Yeah, no, for sure, for sure. That's, again, that comedy tempered my gateway experience into it. Mm. And that I leaned towards that when I got into it. Films like Evil Dead, you know, Evil Dead 2, Army of Darkness, things like that. Mm-hmm. When you add that element of comedy, it just, it goes down a little easier. But then after a while, you crave some of that darker stuff. At least I did anyway.
You crave.
Anything that
we're
made
not
me
a part of that.
Like, you know, the fact that I could see a movie in like Elm Street 3 and I couldn't get it out of my head.
Yeah.
And there wasn't anything I'd really seen before that, you know, a comedy film or something like that. You know, the effects wore off after a while, but stuff like that just lived inside of me. And when you're sitting in the, you know, in your room at night and you got to get up and go to the bathroom and everything's
all
dark.
All right, Trevor, we're done.
Stuff replays in your head, though, right?
We were laughing so hard this morning because we were both checked out your podcast.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And we were going through the titles to figure out, like, oh, which one's going to catch my attention.
Sure.
And everyone, we were both like, nope, nope, no demons, no spirits, nope, nope. I was like, Darren, director,
I'll listen to that one.
Yeah.
I know Saw, because Saw was one of those mm-hmm. movies that, like, I watched the first maybe four, and then I realized, like, why am I doing this to myself? Like, why am I actively freaked out, and, like, my heart feels like it's gonna escape my body. I'm like, I gotta be done with this. And so Saw was kind of like, the Saw franchise was kind of like my last big movies, and I was like, I can't do this to myself anymore. I don't know how you put yourself through these movies, because they freak me out.
What is it for? Is it the suspense? Because it is funny that Dax said that, because we died laughing, because we both were like, that's the one I listened to too. But it was such a beautiful episode to check out.
Oh,
and
thank
I'm
you.
First, like, dead at, oh. For real. For real. We'll edit that out. But just because when you listen, when you guys were talking about all the different elements of, you know, the resounding theme at the end of Saw, right? Because we all have
family
had those.
Family first, right?
Yeah, family yeah, first, right. But also, like, does the dirty bird ever get their day? Because it seems like karma is just hitting snooze button when bad people are out here doing their tomfoolery.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But you have someone, I think it was the director was speaking about, like, they had a family member who had cancer, and they were going
yeah,
through
that's right,
both
yeah.
Their, both his parents, wasn't
Darren
it?
Bousman, yeah, had a parent with cancer. Yes,
yeah.
He was going through the first movie. Yeah, what I find that horror really does a good job at is reflecting things like social issues and doing it through a lens that makes helps you meditate on it even that more, because it's a visceral experience and you're reacting to the things on screen. And again, because it's living in your head over and over again by the attack that it delivers the message, mm-hmm. you really walk away with it, at least I do, mm-hmm. with just a higher appreciation for whatever the, you know, like Dawn of the Dead is all about consumerism, for instance, or, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
There's so many things layered in all these, you know, Jennifer's Body, for instance, one of my favorites,
yeah.
was one of the earliest purveyors of kind of like the Me Too movement.
Yeah.
And it's just a really powerful way of expressing those themes through this lens.
Death becomes her, Vanity.
Right, there
like,
you go, right? Seriously, though.
Alesha.
No, Death Becomes Her is great. I love that movie.
I mean,
yeah.
Know.
Yeah.
Is there any movie that you get into that you start watching and you're like, this is even intense for me?
Yeah, have you and your wife ever looked at each other and like, we've gone too far?
You know, usually she'll back out before I do. Mm-hmm. I'll stay on the ride. There are movies like that, though, that I've had a real hard time with and that honestly have spooked me for a long, long time, mostly involving paranormal stuff.
Yes! Yeah,
paranormal stuff and demonic stuff.
Yep.
Because there's so much.
It's a mind game, then.
And
it's
there's
beyond,
so much
yeah,
evidence of that. It's a very gray area, right? The Catholic Church believes in a lot of this
real.
Stuff, right? Like,
yes.
The Vatican is actively training exorcists right now. That's a story ripped right from
Angie,
the headlines.
What did I tell y'all while we were going? It's a live set, so everyone's in play.
Cool, good.
Angie, I literally said, I said, that's the thing that kind of like really creeps me out when it comes to, I can watch Murder, Kill, Kill, right?
Yeah.
Like, I can do Saw, I can do Hostel, Turistas, even though I know that there are probably some cuckoo juku somewhere paying top dollar to knock off some people. Okay, cool. Not cool, but you get what I'm saying.
Yeah.
But when it, not okay, just so we're clear. It's the demonic and the spirits,
mm-hmm.
because I've had those encounters. I've had a ghost hit me on my knee. You know, I had a bad spirit in my house from a girlfriend that's no longer a girlfriend, should I say. And she bought a bad demon, a tormenting
sure,
spirit.
Sure.
Don't laugh at at me.
No, what I know is like, I talked to Alesha and she was like, listen, the only spirit allowed in my house is Granny, who is going to get me a man.
Come on, talk about it. That is the only spirit allowed in my four walls. Have you ever had a situation like that in your home after doing a podcast where you and your wife were like, was that you or was that me?
I've never had anything like that, fortunately.
Mm-hmm. You think
The closest guest we've had on that kind of gave us a borderline experience is that we had an exorcist come in.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, a woman named R.H. Stavis, and
no,
she wrote
Trevor.
A book. And it was an intense experience. And
what did she say?
The thing I was worried about most is because she has this gift of being able to see demonic attachment. So she can look at a person and she can tell if
I did not want to
I was worried that, hey, if I got something attached.
Look at that!
You know, or if she just said I had something attached, I'd be thinking about it nonstop. I'd be a wreck.
Yeah.
So I was just hoping, man, if she's going to say it, whether you believe it or not, if she's going to say anything. And she didn't. She expressed one of the first things she said in the interview is that she only does that if she's asked specifically.
Did you ask her?
I did not. No way.
You got a demon on your shoulder.
I believe in that stuff way too much.
You got a demon on your back. You got a backpack on.
I'll tell you. No, one of my favorite, there's a podcast that I listen to called Spooked.
Ooh.
I don't think you could take it.
I'm not,
but it's great. Now, the thing is, it's like 5 seasons in right now, but it's firsthand experiences of the paranormal told by the people who went through it.
No.
My gateway was through an episode called The Perfect Tenant, okay? If you're watching this, you gotta check this out. So it's this guy, Stephen LaChance, and it's one of the most documented demonic house possession stories, maybe in history, but it's not really talked about that much. Mm-hmm. The Catholic Church went and investigated it. 156-page document by the Catholic Church saying that this house is infested with demons.
Nope.
And that's from the Catholic Church. So this guy goes on the podcast and basically they bring his story to life through his voice and his words and through the power of sound.
Why would they not be like, and burn it down?
Right? Yeah,
burn
exactly.
it to the ground. Why are people still renting?
Apparently there's the story still happened to this day, as the last I've heard. But
has this person or anyone attached to this been on your show?
Not yet. Not yet. We've tried to get a couple people on.
This will be your last time here.
Right?
the interesting thing is we try to get
some people on, and then stuff happens where the episode isn't able to be recorded.
I'll just let you know, we're doing sage around here after you leave. We're making sure there's enough. You didn't bring anything. Have you ever had Zach Baggins on?
You know what? That's another one that we've been talking about doing. That's another
thing.
I know exactly.
Zach Baggins
is.
Got what he's been doing.
Yeah.
Is slowly accumulating over time the world's most haunted and notorious objects
he
and putting
little,
them all
little,
in one
that,
spot.
That kabuki
everything.
Thingy, right, with the little from the Amity House.
I believe he does.
Yeah.
He's got different things from demonic possession cases. He recently just bought. Was it James Dean's part of the axle?
And he has got
his possessed car, and he's got all this stuff in this one place. And the Demon House, Zach Baggins made a documentary film that we often talk about on the show because I'm terrified of watching it. He made a documentary of a haunted house case. This is insane. So he heard about the case, was so infatuated with it that he bought the house, sight unseen, went out there with a documentary crew, stayed there, and filmed what happened. Now, the case that brought him out there was because a child who was there was seen literally by police, I think, I forget who, like CPS workers, I don't know who it was, but it's well documented, they saw the child walk up a wall.
Well, that's all the time we have
for
today.
Onto the ceiling and flip over.
Oh my
God.
And
this is all documented by many people.
What?
So
and he said, let me get
that
my
story,
things
I guess,
and go stay the night.
So the documentary comes with a warning at the beginning that what you're seeing, there might be evidence that there could be demonic transference digitally.
To you?
Yeah, by watching.
Did
and you
watch
assume
it?
Any risk by seeing it. In fact, when they were cutting the documentary, things were shutting down
Trevor,
with their
did you
technical
watch
equipment.
The documentary?
No,
okay,
way,
you can stay.
No way.
You
but we often talk about it. One of the hosts on our show, Leo, he actually had the guts to watch it. I don't know how, but he said it was terrifying. And then when we've talked about it, we've had listeners who've gone and seen it, and they say they were cold sweats during it. They had to turn it off. All sorts of weird stuff. So I don't know if it's a place I want to venture. But fascinating. Fascinating, though. Still fascinating. So Zach has all this stuff in a museum, and you have to sign a waiver, and he's got the staircase from the demon house. They destroyed it. They ended up destroying the house.
Oh, they did.
And he brought parts of the house to this museum.
The energy is still there,
and people at the museum are having, they had to shut the museum down because someone like passed out underneath where they store, I think it was a rocking chair or something from like the case that The Conjuring 3 was based on, The Devil Made Me Do It, where demonic possession was used in a murder defense trial.
Trevor, you know what I can guarantee you? There isn't one black person. Not one black person who is going to Zach Baggins, Frodo. None of that. We're not doing it.
I love that the entire time you're talking, if you guys go back on the tape, Alesha is clutching.
You are so like beautiful in how you tell a story that I'm enthralled. But at the same time, I'm convinced there's a demon on your back.
That's so
and
funny.
I wanted to stay over there. So I'm like, clutching my cross. Like,
you know, that's the fun thing also about doing the show is because we reach out to not only people who are passionate about the horror genre, but really everybody you talk to has some sort of experience with horror or, you know, haunted or the paranormal, something like that.
Yeah.
Because if you don't have a favorite horror movie, there's usually a reason that's pretty interesting why you don't, right?
Yeah.
Or if that's not your thing, you know, you've had a paranormal experience. For instance, Megan Fox, right? We had her on the show. Ooh, not a fan of horror at all. But the reason being, she was raised in a Pentecostal church. Her father used to perform, her father used to perform exorcisms, and she grew up seeing that stuff and people speaking in tongues and all that stuff. So that was an interesting, you know, she's been in horror movies, so we'll talk about that. And then, well, why don't you watch horror movies? Is there a reason?
So what was that separation for her? Because as an actor, that's a genre I will not do. Don't bother calling me to do the horror film, unless it's like a Saw, because I don't. Is it fair to consider, is Saw or Hostels or Teresa's movies like along that's more like the Seven, like murder, kill, where obviously the music is heightened and the atmosphere is creepy. Stop looking at me like that because it's freaking me out. Cut it out. Is that considered like horror per se, or is that more suspense thriller?
I consider it all horror adjacent.
Okay.
You know, I consider anything with any kind of hint of dark fantasy, like Tim Burton films, I consider it canon in the genre. Yeah, anything. I guess dark art, dark fantasy kind of goes, you know, alongside it. And that's actually how we choose, how we've been kind of actively, as the show's been growing, trying to make it grow further by choosing guests based on looking at the Instagram profiles of who our audience member is, who do they follow, and kind of going after those guests and bringing in things that are horror adjacent. And a lot of these people, it's wild, the kind of target demo, they love Disneyland. Almost all of them love Disneyland, right? They usually have an Etsy shop, or they're a visual artist, or they love listening to true crime podcasts and things like that. So we started incorporating all that, but it's all, to me, it's all kind of canon and the dark
art. You're a big
Disney
fan too, right?
Huge, huge, yeah.
So
big part of the house is dedicated to
Disney. That's so funny, the yin and the yang of it. Like, you spend so much time, like, I'm not necessarily saying that, you know, horror is dark, but, you know, like you said, the dark art of it.
Yeah,
but then, the happiest place on earth. You gotta ease on down that road.
Yeah, but are you like Disney or like Haunted Mansion at Disney?
All of it, really. Of it. I mean, I was drawn into the Haunted Mansion and Pirates of the Caribbean just because it's like, it's like crawling
fantasy
into someone's dream, you know? It's something that was impossible, it was created. And I think also that's why I gravitate to horror and fantasy and dark art a lot, because, you know, in horror movies, a lot of the time, they don't have as big a budget as some of these other, you know, big films, like a Marvel superhero film or something like that. So they have to get really creative when it comes to bringing these stories to life. That's inspiring to see, you know.
And they make a buttload of money.
Right.
Because,
it's true, right?
Not a lot of output.
Films like the Blair Witch Project and the first Paranormal Activity done for nothing that show you the power of good storytelling and what you can do on a modest budget. And it's just really changed. I mean, gosh, now it's such a huge genre. Like, right now, when this is being recorded, cinemas are slowly starting to open back up, and it's horror that is really ushering people back in. That's right. Quiet Place 2 and Spiral and The Conjuring 3 are the movies that really everybody's talking about right now. So
that's what we were talking about. I was, because Angie was talking to us about that, the promo of the kid who's like getting sucked under on the
waterbed.
Yeah,
I had no idea we were talking about the same promo, because I was like, I don't know, but there's this one promo that's out right now that's mad creepy. I think it's The Conjuring, and I messed up one time and I saw it through because of the leads. I'm like, oh, I like their works. And then the moment I started hearing whispers of Satan himself, I'm like, no. And so she was like, oh, that's the one I'm talking about. But so what podcast do you listen to bring you into a happy place? Because I know Spook gets you spooked, but is that the name of it? Spook?
Yeah, Spooked. That right? Yeah, that's right. I mean, I have a passion for collecting things from movies and TV shows that I love. Yeah. So there's a prop podcast that I like called Prop History.
And are they just talking about what they're finding or what's available? Or
that's
what?
Part of it. A lot of the things, they'll spend episodes just talking about like 1982's John Carpenter's The Thing, which had a lot of practical effects and it was kind of the birthplace of a lot of what they're doing in modern horror films by making things look grotesque and real. And they just will have guests on from some of these things or places that sell or that go and hunt for remnants of film and TV and put them in auctions. And I love listening to that because that, like, really, that's probably my biggest hobby. I'm obsessed with that.
I really like the prop thing and like behind the scenes of movies. Yeah. So when you were talking to Darren the other day on the podcast, I liked him revealing the wall behind, like, oh, when we were doing a Spiral, that it was forced perspective and that them being inside the subway tunnel wasn't really a subway tunnel. And it was actually, if you step back 3 feet, he would have hit the wall.
Yeah.
Like that stuff to me
that
is
movie
so
magic stuff is fascinating. And the ability when you are able to hold the screen, use prop, and sometimes you'll see the trick, the illusion. Yeah. Like right now, there's an auction coming up and they're selling a pair of Hugh Jackman Wolverine claws. Mm-hmm. Right?
That's
and you see the trick behind him,
my
and it's so simple.
It.
Basically, these claws that look like they're coming out of his knuckles, all he's doing is holding a pad. They're attached to this pad, and when he's palming the claws like that, it looks like they're in his skin, but they're literally just a handle that he's holding in each thing. It's not even put on digitally. It's a great old school, sleight of hand magic trick, and it's just awesome.
What did you
I
say that? What
that
name
stuff.
Of that podcast was?
Prop History.
Prop History.
Yeah.
It's so funny,
because
I do think that that's where you and I finally have found our sweet spot, Trevor, is just the imagination of horror, because they do have to dig a little deep, because like you said, the budget isn't there. And I think probably too, that's what adds to the heightened sensationalism of it all, because the viewer adds their imagination. We go a little deeper.
Yeah.
Well, could that actually happen? Is that real? Because of movie magic, it
creates
the atmosphere that can happen.
And that's what we've actually built kind of when we started the podcast. The whole idea was to build it into an experience, because obviously this past year we haven't had any impersonal guests, right? But when we started, we had people coming over to the house, and we would get a guest, book a guest, see who we get, we shoot for the moon. One of our first guests was Danny Elfman.
Whoa.
We still don't know. Composer, right?
Huge.
Oingo Boingo was the band that kind of changed music for forever.
Did I say that right?
Yeah, Oingo Boingo, And he went on and, created the music for, Nightmare Before Christmas and countless others, probably one of the most.
You're getting Megan Fox on your podcast. Right. Doing pretty well.
He's a composer?
So, composer. So we had him come to the house, and it's funny because, we don't tell anybody it's at a house. They just show up at this address.
And is it your
is it
house?
Your
and
house?
It's my house. And they get a little freaked out. You know, when they go and say, where am I at a house? Open the door. And it was kind of like a psychological experiment to see who we could get over and then watch their faces as they see all this
stuff. Do you videotape
stuff.
That process?
We haven't
have
started
to.
Doing it. We just got a TV show during the pandemic, and it's all been through Zoom, though. It's all been through Zoom. We haven't had the opportunity to film anyone actually going through the thing. And then the studio itself, we got a panic room company to help us build the studio. And they basically took a wall, and we burrowed a hole through the wall, and they built this electromagnetic bookcase that's triggered by a book, and it's got a piece of mercury inside, and when the mercury tilts, so when you tilt the book, it triggers all these electromagnets, and the bookcase opens, and you are in this Victorian era recording studio.
Dope! I now want to come over
and see.
Please come.
Trapdoors, you got
right.
me.
Yeah, trapdoors. So I've always dreamed about doing that. So the whole thing was just kind of like an extension of that dream. So we've really kind of built the house and the studio and the podcast as it's just kind of, to really dive into the spirit of imagination and dreaming. God. And I love being around that stuff. It's inspiring.
Tell the wife I'm coming over.
Please
do. Seriously,
I'm
bringing the sage. We're coming. I am bringing sage just in case.
I'll tell you, as dark as it gets, the very first prop, screen use prop that we got was the notebook from the movie The Notebook. Oh. So it goes that way
so
as well.
You set the atmosphere.
It goes that way as well.
You have the actual notebook?
Yeah. Aww.
That's cool.
Can I have it? You're already married. I need to bring that love into my
An amazing prop to have.
That's really cool. Yeah, we just got one of Ryan Gosling's main costumes from that movie as well, screen matched, and we're stoked to have
okay,
that.
Okay, we're coming over. Let's go look at your house.
So it's not just horror, you know, there's a big component of it for sure.
We'll start with the horror, just so I can get the sour, and then I want to end.
We'll get as sweet as it gets.
The notebook. That's as sweet as it gets. The pit stop, you say. Cool.
Man, Trevor, your life is fascinating. I'm telling you, we're coming over.
Whether you're inviting us or not,
we're coming over to check out the trapdoor, the notebook, the whole thing. For people that want to check out your podcast, the Boo Crew Podcast, it is on the Odyssey app or wherever you find your podcast.
Yeah.
He is Odyssey family, straight Odyssey family. So
this has been the longest interview that we've had, as you can tell. And to say that I was saging the atmosphere before you even got in here, but I'm enthralled.
That's awesome. You are a phenomenal talent.
Hey. I'm just like, yes.
Thank you.
You better sell that horror.
To let you know, too, I started another podcast that's coming out. Mm-hmm. We just got put on a network as well called The Bleeders DIEgest. And that is bringing original horror stories to life.
Oh,
so that's been a new project. So using theater of the mind and really getting your imagination.
Oh, audibly.
Audibly.
Yeah.
That's cool.
I won't be checking that out.
But we wish you a lot of luck.
Send it to you. You and that demon on your
right. Yeah.
Thank you, Trevor.
Hey, thank you.
You guys don't go anywhere. This is Podsauce.